What up, what up, what up, y'all? In this video, we're going to talk about the logical exclusive OR operation. Let's jump right in with a definition. We're going to call this the logical XOR operation, and we do this on two propositions. We say that the logical XOR of propositions P and Q is denoted as the letter X, no space, and then the word OR. So that's read XOR. So this whole sequence right here is XOR parentheses P comma Q. We say that the XOR proposition is read P XOR Q, and that proposition P XOR Q is true when exactly one, but not both, P or Q is true. We can actually define this logical XOR based on the truth table that we see on screen here. So when we're looking at P, Q, and then P XOR Q, we say that P XOR Q is true when exactly one of them is true, but not both of them. So if P is false and Q is false, certainly P XOR Q will be false. If P is false but Q is true, well, exactly one of those is true, so P XOR Q is true as well. If P is true and Q is false, P XOR Q must be true because exactly one of those is true. And then we exclude the possibility that both of them are true for the exclusive OR. Another way to say that is, in the last case where P is true and Q is true, it is not true that exactly one of those is true because specifically both of them are true. The XOR is true when exactly one of them is true, thus P XOR Q in this last case is false. Remember we said there was a difference between inclusive OR and exclusive OR, and we told that little joke about the mathematician going to the restaurant. In this situation, when a mathematician goes into a restaurant and the waiter asks, would you like soup or salad, the waiter really should be saying, would you like soup, exclusive OR, salad, because they mean which of the two, but not both, are true. Mathematical waiter should say, would you like soup, inclusive OR, salad, and I don't mind losing my job because I'm going to give you both. In MATLAB, the exclusive OR doesn't have an operator symbol, but is actually written as the exclusive OR function. Let's go ahead and take a look at this by typing help XOR. Notice this is a logical exclusive OR, and it's done exactly as we see here. So I would read this as P XOR Q, but it's done in function notation where we take two inputs and then the output captures the truth value for the individual entries. The discussion that we had previously where we were looking at compatible array sizes for binary operations definitely applies to the exclusive OR function. Of course, I'm always going to start with the concept of testing this on logical scalars. So let's set P to be a true proposition, one by one logical scalar. We'll set Q to be a false proposition, one by one logical scalar. And then we'll actually take XOR P Q, in other words, P XOR Q. Notice that must be true because exactly one of the component parts is true. I could also test the situation where P is true and Q is true. When I take P XOR Q, so let's do P XOR Q, in that situation, the output is false because both of them is true, which means exactly one is not true. The flip side is if I take P OR Q, that is an inclusive OR because it includes the situation where at least one of them is true. So both could be true and OR will still output a true statement. In all three of these examples, we're looking at these operations on logical scalars. We could, of course, operate these on logical vectors. We're going to do something different in this video. We're going to do information stored in logical row vectors rather than column vectors. So let's go ahead and capture the data 0, 0, 1, 1. So the first column of this matrix is going to be this row vector. When I push enter, that's exactly what we see. We'll capture Q also as a logical row vector of the same size. So in this situation, we're going to say 0, 1, 0, 1. And then what we'll do is we'll take XOR P Q. Let's see if we can figure out what this would be. The first entry is going to compare 0 XOR 0. That would be 0. 0 XOR 1 would be 1. 1 XOR 0 would be 1. 1 XOR 1 would be 0 because it flops that inclusive to exclusive. When we push enter, notice it's a row vector that captures the XOR operation, and that's exactly what we see in the column of this table. We've just turned that into row vectors. We could, of course, transform this table into, instead of column information, row information. So let's do that. We'll say the first column is stored as the first row. the second column is stored as the second row, and then we'll say X OR P Q. Notice the rows of that matrix are the columns of this table, which is exactly what we thought would happen. Let's take a look at using XOR on non-vector logical matrices. We're going to refer back to an example that we've done in previous videos. We had this matrix A that stored non-zero row vectors and a matrix B that stored non-zero column vectors, each one being placed in every other position. We could turn those into logical matrices using the logical function, where we're identifying the non-zero entries of each of those places. Here, we've already stored both LA and LB in memory. That's from a previous video. If you need to remind yourself how we did that, please go back and watch that now. The point of the matter, though, is when I take the LA XOR LB, what I'm going to do is compare the individual entries of each of those using the XOR function. So let's do entry 1-1 of LA XOR entry 1-1 of LB. 1 XOR 0, notice that's going to be 1 XOR 0 is going to get a 1 there, because we're literally identifying where are exactly one of those two propositions true. When I look at entry 1-2, 1 XOR 1 is going to be 0 because two of those are true simultaneously, meaning the output is false in the XOR command. So I'm going to have a 1 in position 1. I'm going to have a 0 in position 2. Similarly, I'm going to have a 1 in position 3 because 1 XOR 0 is 1. And then 0 in position 4. Claim, I can continue on like this, and that's exactly what I do. If I take XOR LA LB, notice I get this really fun pattern of diagonals. So I have a main diagonal and I have kind of off diagonals where every other one is identified as true. If we compare that with the OR operation, notice ORs are going to have ones in special places because it is an inclusive OR. It includes the capability of having both propositions true at the same time. Of course, we can also use XOR with arrays of compatible sizes. We've done a video of that in the past. So if you want a reminder, please go back and watch that video. In this case, what we'll do is we'll do an XOR. We'll compare the entire matrix LA with the complement or the negation of the third row of LB. Let's go ahead and check this real quick. So remember that the rows of LB actually store the locations of the non-zero element. So if I take the third row of this matrix, let's go ahead and do that now. The non-zeros in the third row are going to be position 2, 4, and 6. And then what I'm saying is, let's find the position of the zeros. The zeros in that situation are going to be in positions 1, 3, and 5. Then when I take XOR LA not LB, what I'm asking is, where is exactly one of LA either non-zero or the third row of LB zero? Show me those locations. That is stored in this matrix, which is kind of the opposite of what we've seen previously. The point of this is that we can use compatible array sizes and also nest logical operations inside the input of other logical operations, which we've seen before. One thing I will say is this is kind of a complex mechanism. Every time we use these logical operations, we actually have to be kind of strategic and think critically about what we want and why we want it. We'll see more of that as we use these to do branching statements. That ends the tutorial portion of this video and leads us to our community challenge for today. Community challenge on this video is to think critically, why would we want an XOR proposition rather than just an OR proposition? Another way to ask that question is, why did the people at MATLAB spend extra time coding up XOR? I will say that we actually don't have access to the source code on this. In other words, if I actually try to open the XOR function, MATLAB holds that as proprietary information. This is blind to the user. So it would seem to reason that there is some special functionality here. Why do you think MATLAB actually spent the extra time to code this? What additional functionality do we get that we didn't have just using AND, NOT, and OR? Of course, I always welcome your questions, comments, concerns, and feedback. I grow when you give me feedback. Thank you so much for your attention. I'll see you in the next video.